seasons: summer, fall, winter. Let's start with this winter. I taught a class here, we're on Zoom, but for the Creative Center. And it was for older adults and people living with chronic illness. And I taught them all my Lower East Side solo performance shit. And hello, I'm so glad some of you came. And, you know, the day was coming, the winter day, January 17th, when they were going to do their performance. And I was really scared. I was really nervous. I was like, why did I have them do all this stuff? And then I was thinking about this day. I was already dreading this moment, March 11th, 6 p.m. Oh, my God. I was walking around in the freezing fucking cold. By New York Harbor, I called my great friend, Penny Arcade, the great performance artist. And she said, Heather, you want to know what your piece is about? You're teaching older adults. This must be about you aging, Heather. What have you learned? Penny, I've learned that I'm a bad teacher and that I'm just putting them through the same stupid process torment that I go through. Okay, no, Heather, but what have you learned? What have they taught you? So their performance came on January 17th, and it was magic, and it was dimensional, and all of their performances were courageous, and we called it Tapestry of the Lost and the Found. And one thing I learned was, well, hey, maybe some of this Lower East Side performance art shit stuff that I taught them, maybe it did work. Maybe it helped, you know, because there was this kind of edge to it that I really liked. And so in tribute to them, I decided to do those things and give you a fable number one, a little ditty, which would be, you know, using props in a crazy way and doing my own prompts. I call them recipes, but they're prompts. Okay, so without any further ado, here it is. Hey, yeah, Jack. Thanks for taking my call. You in the middle of your day, kiddo? Oh, that's good, yeah. How's that class going, the social media thing, the career and, yeah, well, that's terrific. Oh, yeah, that's great. I mean, I'm glad it's working for you. Yeah, well, you keep going, and I mean, everybody needs, hello, what? No, I think there's kind of an early spring happening here, and I'm just walking around, allergies maybe. You know, your mom went to Target to pick up some things for the, yeah, she's, you know, she's her garden, of course, but she's having this little hoedown, with the Tuckermans and Judy and, you know, the family across the Perry and Glynis and the 11-year-old son, yeah. Wow. It seems like, you know, so long ago, and yet, you know, no more in the blink of an eye when you were his age, Lakota's age. Well, that's his name, isn't it? Oh, Cheyenne, okay, yeah. Right, no, Cheyenne. Yeah, they're both Native American tribes, so my brain just did the old switcheroony. Never mind. It doesn't happen to you. Just wait. It will. I hope it doesn't. Yeah. Oh, whoop. No, I just tripped. No, I'm fine. It's just quiet. It's just quiet time a lot, you know? It's a lot of quiet time. Oh, no, I'm enjoying it. I'm digging it, yeah. I might go fishing. Yeah, Rand said that he might have time off from the advertising freelance that he's doing. Yeah, they don't give us old admin steady jobs anymore. Yeah, but Rand, you know, he goes for it. He gets the freelancing. Oh, yeah, he hustles. He's a hustler. He gets it, you know? Yeah. But, so he said he might have
some time next month, you know, some time. And we might go fishing, you know, down at the old Clyderman rock holler, like we used to. Yeah. That river is so damn pretty. Just the weeping willows and the aspens and the fish and those rocks. We used to dip in, then we'd lie on those rocks. Remember, dry off. Remember that? Just remember that feeling of that hot, sun-warmed stone and just coming up through your skin, through your bones. Yeah, maybe we'll do that again sometime. You know, I was thinking about it. I think I really enjoyed those trips because I'd be busy as hell on some stressful campaign, you know, pulling the all-nighters, you know, really bringing the old brains out, you know, for that tagline, for that perfect pitch sell, you know? And it was so beautiful when after all that shit, you know, and the headaches and not getting it, you would finally come, you know? Eureka, like a ship in the mist, like a sun breaking up the clouds, there it is, yeah! We got it and we'd work at it. And at last, you know, finally the fucker would launch and then we'd have the glossies and the taglines and all the clients would be happy. And then we'd take those trips, yeah. Just a few days fishing and swimming off of those rocks. And it felt like heaven, you know, just you and me and Rand and Tyler. Yeah, you and Tyler, you were such cute little boys, you know, little buddy boys. Now it just seems like I gotta wait a month for Rand. You know? Mom, she's around. She's around, but she keeps busy, you know? All her causes and clubs and the house and the garden. And even in the winter, she's always doing shit with that garden. And the time just gets a little stretchy, you know? I always treasured that time off, those 3 days. You know, I just wanted them to go on forever, just golden, just perfect. But they didn't, you know, they ended fast, and it was back to work. And I always longed for this, just to be free. But now I am, and it seems like everybody's got their thing, you know? They got their campaign. I don't have a campaign anymore, just days and hours. Oh, you gotta go, kiddo. Yeah, next class, yeah, what's up next? Oh, you're meeting friends, yeah, volleyball. Okay, that's even better. Okay, enjoy it, kid. You know, it's the time of your life. You keep kicking ass, son, okay? Oh yeah, I'm cool. I'll call you again on the weekend? Okay, yeah. Okie doke, smokes. Catch you on the downbeat, jazz man. Adios. Adios. All right. Bye-bye. endeavors, you need to keep your numbers up
by following the 5 precepts. Okay, so every time you put that zippered bag back in the electrified truck and you get ready for your next delivery of customer fulfillment as yours, excuse me. Give me that bag.
Just come join me.
So, yeah. I had this dream last night, and then I couldn't sleep anymore. So I came out and I sat at the kitchen table, and I just looked into the dark, you know, until the sun began to lighten the sky. And I thought of all the tens of thousands of people crushed under the stones and cement in Turkey and Syria. Yes, the earthquake. It's a terrible tragedy to take in.
It is.
Yes. What feelings were you having?
Feeling being crushed, but not really.
What was this feeling?
Just a dark heaviness in my body. But also, I'm doing nothing. I haven't given money. Nothing.
Would you like to give money?
Yeah, I mean, I guess I'd like to give money. I'd like to give money, but it wouldn't, I mean, I don't know how to help. I'm not there helping. You know, I'm not a person trained to go there and help.
No, you weren't.
So I don't know if feeling them and praying that they get found and rushed to a hospital or, you know, just slip away somewhere serene and tranquil, you know, praying for them not to be afraid and in any more pain, but just go off somewhere. You know, I don't know if that helps. But I do it anyway. But, you know, I've given no money. I've given no help.
It seems like, since money is the one thing that you feel you can do, besides imagining what it feels like. No, I'm not imagining. It's just feeling. It's just simply feeling. Okay, yes. So, in addition to this feeling and the prayer, it seems like giving money might also help you feel that you are able to do something very teeny tiny. Yes, small, but at least helpful.
Yeah, but I don't, because I can't move. I'm immobile. I hate the computer. I don't want to have to turn on the computer to give them money.
Okay. What does that feel like?
It feels like the dream, waking up from the dream.
Do you want to tell me about this dream you're having?
Yeah. So it's like an old 1950s blue truck. You know, the rounded ones, you know, they didn't have corners, they had
an old truck.
Right. And it's at the end of a dirt road. It's the end. There are these blackberry brambles. It's over, you know, and I have a small brown bird fly into my hand. Or maybe it's just there, but anyway, then I let it go. Or it just goes and it flies over. It goes over the end of the road. But that's it. It's just in the dust at the end of this dirt road. Feels like us.
Your relationship?
No, us.
You and I?
No, just us. All of us. End of the road. The bird is dead. You know? That's why it gets to fly.
Ah,
over the rainbow. Really, yeah. But we just sit here idling in the truck. We sit, you know, but we can't go on. We're at the end of the road.
OK.
Okay, well, it looks like it's 5 past the hour. Okay, so it's the end of the session, I guess, as well as the end of the road. It is. Ha. Huh. Okay, thanks. See you next week. See you next week. This is a mic. Oh, there we go. So, another thing that I feel like I learned from my students was that life changes our story. The story we have about ourselves can change drastically. And it's great to be able to tell that story. As you have a changing story, it's good to be able to tell that changing story. And sometimes tell it in completely new forms that you've not tried before. And so this fall and summer, I tried a new form that's far more documentary and first-person narrative than my previous work. This fall, I did something called Whistle Stop Swing, which was a sort of travelogue that I put on Substack. And I decided to take the train across the country from New York to Los Angeles during the midterms and canvas in 5 different swing states, get off the train and stay with different different people, canvas for Democrats, because I hope to save at least a chance of democracy for our country, if not the actual real deal. And anyway, so I went from New York to Philadelphia, to Pittsburgh, to Toledo, Ohio, to La Crosse, Wisconsin, and then I took a little side trip to the heartland, which was sort of the heart of the emotional matter for me. I met my brother in Minneapolis, and we took this car trip to Woodlake, Wisconsin, which was a place that my mother took sanctuary with a Swedish farming family when she was a girl, and her parents, who were investigative journalists, were having serious troubles due to my grandfather's investigations in the Twin Cities. And ultimately, my grandfather was killed. And this place was a place that my mother really treasured, and this Swedish family was a family she always remembered. So my brother and I had these last little ashes remaining of my mother. She died in 2008. And we went to Woodlake, Wisconsin, and we left her ashes, and we met members of this Swedish family who were still going strong. And anyway, I won't share that with you, though, because it's a big, long part, and it would take over. So the parts I'm going to share with you are when I got to Toledo, which is sort of the middle of my trip, and then sort of the tail end leading up to finally being in Phoenix. So I went from my side trip to the heartland to Austin, and then Phoenix is where I ended up. All right, so without further ado, a tale of two Toledos. Actually, maybe 4 Toledos. But I'm a sucker for alliteration. So, seedy, scenic, central, and suburban. Day 1, Toledo arrival, Tuesday, 5:35 a.m. Seedy. "Oh, you want the city bus," says the Amtrak agent behind the plexiglass. She's affable, round-cheeked, brown hair. "You need to walk up the hill, and it's around the Circle K gas station, just up around there." The night train from Pittsburgh, barreling its way to Chicago, deposits me and a handful of others, a Dayton housewife, some Amish folk, other plain-type people of assorted ethnicities, in a small, valiantly Art Deco train station, curving vinyl benches,
worn at the seams, displays of model trains, nostalgia photos of the railroad's glory days, and a handwritten sign that reads, "Defend train service." It's still dark outside. The sun won't be up for 2 more hours. All the others go off in cars or board an Amtrak bus to carry them to points more obscure. But for some reason, I don't want an Uber. It feels creepy in this moment. And so I trudge up this hill to scope, look for the Circle K. It's kind of hard to see it. Oh, there, I see it. And then I pull my bags back down to the station again a couple of times. I do this like a few times. I'm chickening out walking to the bus stop because although there are some perfectly respectable, humble houses off of this deserted paved circle of MLK Junior Plaza, there's also this stretch of warehouses and a vine-bordered sidewalk that looks murky. So the third time out, I summon my nerve and I hit that stretch. And it turns out not so bad. There's actually a big house and a lawn with some kids' toys and cars right beyond the overgrown vines. So I make it to the Circle K convenience store and gas station at the convergence of two industrial boulevards. And I wait in a gritty, not cold wind. And I notice two white men, possibly a father and a son, who sit heads down by the store's entrance. Latino immigrants in pickups whiz by on their way to work. On the bus are more blue-collar people on their way to work, plus a couple of white street people. It costs $1.50, and the bearded, pasty-faced bus driver takes his time. Oh, I can't seem to get the, oh, finally, he helps me get my uncooperative dollar bill in the theater. Scenic. 4 stops later, I'm in the built-up downtown. I find a brightly lit place called City Egg, which borders a new medical complex located on a terraced waterfront promenade on the Maumee River. City Egg offers decent coffee, avocado toast on kind of weird-tasting bread, and a blessedly pristine restroom. I avail myself. The Egg is operated by a lone young woman, calm, methodical, brown hair pulled back, a soft moon face without makeup. When I tell her it's my first time in Toledo, she and a sweet middle-aged early morning regular sporting a cheerful shade of lipstick both welcome me. Seems to me there's nothing to do here, but I'm sure if you're from somewhere else, says the counterwoman. The river's pretty, I say, because the sun has now come up and I can catch a glimpse. The counterwoman gives me a sly smile. The lady customer grins kindly. Have a nice vacation here. I walk to the river and I write in my journal. The sun is rising over the Maumee and I sit feet up on the cement dock in a red city supplied lawn chair facing the eastern shore. Gulls circle. The river is wide and glassy, puckered with the slightest breeze. It is another warm day here on the lip of the Midwest. Later, from a posh hotel lobby, where I didn't have to pay a cent, I didn't have to pay a dime. The whole time I was there, the hostesses let me hang out and I didn't pay a dime. I continue in my journal. Gorgeous early morning on the water with swans aswim. I saw an old multi-arched bridge designed for admitting vessels and yellow leaves falling sideways to the riverbank. And gleefully, oh good, I've gone to the luxury hotel bathroom, left all the rest here with a nice hostess, wheeled my luggage, switched tops, put deodorant, did hair and makeup, pink, lipstick and jackets. Feel very Toledo, Ohio. I then reported to the Tim Ryan office down the street for canvassing duty. Central. Field organizer M, long black hair with
dynamite bangs, drives me to my turf in central Toledo. I'll knock 40 doors on my own, and then she'll come and back and pick me up. The campaign I'm supporting is called Workers First, and M fills me in on the day's mission as she navigates the freeway. The one early voting location in all of Toledo has been switched from downtown, accessible to those in central and other inner city neighborhoods, to a location high up in the suburban hills on Sylvania Avenue near the Franklin Park Mall. I was to tell people, get out there, bank your vote early, if at all possible to make it out there. Another obstacle for voters to clear was that the mail-in ballots, which many elderly people favor, had been getting sent back for not having enough postage. So make sure to tell them to put 2 stamps on it, a dollar's worth, one old woman voter would tell me later, and mail it right away. Better yet, you know, persuade them to just go vote in person, just to be sure. This led to the third impediment to be aware of. The polling locations had been switched, so that the place people have been used to voting for years is no longer the place. So make sure to check their polling place and tell them. M is a student at University of Toledo and advocates strongly for people her age staying in Toledo and in Ohio. That's why she's involved in this Workers First campaign. She wants to make her region a place where people, young people, are doing well and desire to remain. I ask about the main industries of Toledo. Having gleaned from the historic plaques down by the Maumee River that it was once a teeming port for travelers and the shipment of coal and farm goods. She tells me it's still farming. Corn? Yeah, corn. But soy. Oh, soy. Right, and I think soy feed, livestock feed, soy-fed livestock. And the medical industry, she tells me, that's growing. I tell her, oh yeah, yeah, I saw the big new ProMedica building down by the waterfront. M drops me on Tecumseh Street. In the middle of a small grid of blocks that I will walk with names such as Buckingham, Hamilton, Junction, and Nebraska, evoking a motley crew of associations. Old England, Founding Father, turn of the century infrastructure, and the Great Plains. But Tecumseh is something special. Shawnee leader, orator, warrior who resisted the USA's land grab of his native Ohio. What the War of 1812 was really about, I've recently learned from combing around Ontario backcountry with my Canadian husband and getting their view of what happened. Wresting Indian-held lands protected by British treaty away from the tribes allied with Canada. Tecumseh, with his pan-indigenous visioning brother, founded Prophet's Town, as in prophecy, not prophet, and from there sought to unify Indian nations into a single resistant confederacy. Now there is a confederacy I can get behind, and win back Ohio. Allied with the Brits, he was killed in the War of 1812, and both Prophet's Town and Ohio were lost forever to his people. Tecumseh Street is poorly paved with humps of ruptured cement creating cracks and potholes. Grass and weeds, brambles and trees of many varieties and colors grow freely along its sidewalks and in empty stretches of yard. The houses that line it are mainly humble, white, traditional clapboard, or vinyl-sided, often with a single front-facing gable under a reddish or green tar shingled roof and looking out over a porch. Almost everyone has a front and a back porch. The fronts are either enclosed with screens or plastic or glass panels or open, classic front porches. Come on up and sit down here, a young-looking 83-year-old man tells me. Lightly bearded, open button shirt with some sort of medical-related gear hanging around his neck, skin like smooth-worn leather. Thank you, darling, I say. That sun is hitting you right in your eyes. I know, I said, it's gotten hot. Yes, it had, you hardly wear anything.
Ha!
True that. In walking Tecumseh, I'd had to peel off both my pink jacket layers donned gleefully that morning in the posh downtown hotel's luxury restroom, and now I was down to my sleeveless, body-hugging, blue top over jeans, and my prominent, sparkling crucifix necklace, the American Express gold card of my canvassing uniform. We sat in his comfortable, leaning-back chairs, metal chairs, and talked. He told me that he used to always volunteer at the polls, but that now he was done. He would, however, vote the Democratic slate that I handed off to him, all the crucial Ohio Supreme Court judges, state representatives for Ohio legislature, and Representative Marcy Kaptur, whose normally safe U.S. House seat was in play due to redrawn district lines. And of course, Tim Ryan for Senate. I imparted the information M had primed me with, and he pulled back his head and said, "Now, why would they do that about the early vote site relocation?" I wonder, I said. He was glad of the information, and he said he'd spread the word. As he saw me off down the steps, I said, "God bless you." "God bless you too," he said. And we meant it. I continued climbing the steps to the porches, often painted black and hot pink, I noticed. I passed through brightly planted flower beds and one laden apple tree, its many fruits decomposing in the grass. The older man there said, "Someone used to come and take them away for him for cider, applesauce, but no more, and he couldn't handle all these apples nowadays." Most places, when people were home, they were elderly, and they would invite me up on the porch. I sat with more than one older person who told me of their own or their sick spouse's medical problems. I told each one that I would pray for them, and they thanked me. In particular, I recall one pale, lightly mustached, frail old woman in a purple top, whose daughter would maybe drive her to the Franklin Park Mall, but she had an eye operation and a COVID test coming up. She really wanted to vote. I noted her information down and suggested the campaign get some help to her. Close your eyes for a moment with me and wish the power of well-being to each of these gracious souls whom I encountered. As I've noted, the last door is often the one that makes a difference. Nebraska, a more commercial and gritty avenue, was where I came upon my final porch of elderly people, a neighbor couple visiting an older woman, all of them voting. The wife of the couple had a beautiful to me face. Her skin was the color of angst, and her eyes and look were from another era, like a farm woman. This other era-ness often seems the case in the Midwest. The USA has so many different people and regions. I'm continually reminded whenever I take a cross-country trip such as this. She was an adamant constituent of Marcy Kaptur and talked about how well Marcy had represented them for many years. I asked where the young person on my list might be. Let's call him Desmond. "Oh, he's right over there in the car." I walked over to the young man in a parked SUV in the driveway. Good looking, leather coat, trimmed facial hair. He looked up from his phone and engaged me. "I've been thinking." "Oh, believe me," he said. "I've been thinking and I've been reading." After we got done with his absurd argument that females should only be permitted one exemption from outlawed abortion, since males were not exempted from supporting children they'd not chosen to give birth to, we moved on to the economy. He said that all politicians were liars and did nothing to improve his community's lives. I rattled off all the material improvements to Toledo lives that the Inflation Reduction Act provides and how 100% of Republicans had voted against it. "The Inflation Reduction Act?" he said, incredulous. "Yeah. You like to read. Google it. Finally, I got pissed off. Not at him, but at the red states. I told him not voting was a vote for them to keep control of our lives. I'm a 16th generation American, I said. Probably he is too. And I know white people. I warned him that the civil rights of women and black people, such as they are, will be stripped further away by giving the red state whites full power. I saw something soften in his face. It was time to leave. I said it was great talking to him. Yes, it was, he said. The Inflation Reduction Act. And then Desmond gave me an earnest young man smile. On a bench in front of the local community center at the corner of Junction and Tecumseh, I sat and rested from knocking 40 doors and waited for my ride. A stick-thin older man, clothes covered in paint, came walking past. Oh, Lord, are my bones tired? Oh, he said. I second that emotion, I said. My feet are sore. He sat to rest beside me and asked what I'd been out here doing. We talked politics a while, and also painting, because my husband, too, is a house painter. So we talked who had painted their own house, who needed to patch their roof better, get the vinyl siding up before winter. He'd just come from a job for an old African immigrant lady. He'd undercharged her, he told me, because she needed the work done. She didn't speak English very well. When I told him about the early voting at the mall, he suggested a bus ought to be arranged on Sunday, and everyone come get on it and go vote. Back at the downtown HQ, I relayed his suggestion. We are doing just that, said Dee, the young black field organizer. Great minds think alike, I said. I hoisted my backpack, wheeled away my luggage, and wished them great good luck on November 8th. I made for the bus stop to catch my bus to the suburbs of Toledo. And I will not include the suburbs here, although it was a great study in contrasts. And I had a great audio conversation that I recorded with MAGA Republicans in the parking lot, who were actually rather charming. And also Erica White, who is an African-American candidate for the Ohio State Assembly. She won. She was a AT&T line woman union organizer. Anyway, but now I'm going to take you to Arizona. Arizona arrival and Texas train ride in the belly of the beast. And this is right before... couple days before election. Last night, just before Tucson, the dude sitting behind me, drooping mutton chops, sloping belly, a longhorn cap, jacket, t-shirts, jeans, 60s, insisted on standing in the aisle and talking to me. He looked at me portentously, as if something was up. But I didn't know what. I was just jonesing to read my Poke Rafferty thriller, Street Music, and get off in Maricopa, Arizona after Tucson, take the cab I'd phoned ahead for with the local Jay's Rides, and go collapse at the Inn by Wyndham Corp after 28 hours on the train from Austin. But no, this dude stood there looking at me, whites of his gray eyes shining in the train car rack lights. And then he sat down beside me and asked if it was all right. It wasn't, but I'd been social on this raucous, loquacious Texas Eagle, then rehooked in San Antonio to Sunset Limited ride, and I didn't want to be rude. I mean, he'd been my fellow traveler for the past several hours. He was a piano tuner and a musician, and he liked the old songs, and he thought this was maybe why they fired him. Singing at the elder homes. The number 421, San Antone to Los Angeles, seemed to be full of liquored up old white men, some of whom had been handsome and charming once, and none of whom admitted they were not so much any longer. They got progressively soused as the train spread and crawled across the endless scrubbed and mesquited beauty of West Texas, Mexican mountain ranges, bits of an idiotic fence, dwarfed by the landscape, but nonetheless marring it. Then came the veritable enchantments of New Mexico, peaks and buttes, and a glory-bound caramel flan sunset
over the indescribable flowing brows, noses, and elbows of rim rock reflected as fire in temporary lakes formed by a high desert flash flood. Among the passengers was also a florid blonde MAGA lady with American flag insignia blouse leading a loud card game on the observation deck and saying shit like, "This year they passed a law against dead people voting." There were black men and women, old and young, keeping their cool, having a laugh. And there was a handful of friends that I made, interesting, alive, adventuring people. And I recorded conversations with them, but you're not going to get them. You have to go to my Substack page, because this is all about me. And there was a smattering of Euros and Kiwis witnessing it all, and sometimes offering comment. An older New Zealand gentleman wearing a t-shirt that featured botanical illustrations came up and thanked me for a loud conversation I'd had on the observation deck with a kind elderly Austinite about child separation policy. Yeah, they rip babies away from their mother's breasts. It's early Nazi behavior. Oh, I had no idea. Oh yeah, it's in the Atlantic. I'll give you a copy. Of course, mutton chops bound for Tucson turned out to believe that Fauci was a criminal who should be executed, refused to acknowledge that way over a million Americans had died from COVID, and our conversation ended with me saying, "Well, I'll pray for you. I'll pray that what you say is true, because then all those doctors and nurses would not be dead, but they are, and believing won't bring them back to life. God bless." And him saying, "They're destroying this country. Rand Paul knows a lot." And me saying, "God bless. I'll pray for you to have compassion and be enlightened. God bless." And him muttering, "The road to hell is paved with good intentions." And me thinking, "Really? What good intentions are those? I haven't seen any on the road to hell. You and your Antichrist are taking us all down." As I write this, in the La Quinta by Wyndham lobby, they are broadcasting Fox on a widescreen TV. "Note to self, tell Julie, who I met in Pittsburgh, to add corporations who publicly air Fox to her Stop Fox Disinfo Protest Org activities." Yes, we are in Beast Belly, Arizona, as my cousin in Austin coined it before he dropped me off at the train station two nights ago. It is the day before the election. I have slept and drank hotel coffee, witnessed grackles strutting cutely past sculpted balls of bush in the gravel and mesquite parking lot. I've met Jay, nice-looking black man, 50s, from Detroit, came to visit his grown son, and then never left, moved here. I've smelled the manure on the desert night wind, which Jay explained was from the nearby dairy farm. And soon, I'll go volunteer for the embattled congressional member, Tom O'Halloran. Jay will drive me. Sundown at Indian School Road Apartments. Last get out the vote, last ride. So this is like right before the polls closed. We had split up and crunched the gravel paths, searching for voters who had opened their thin, steel, brick-red doors at dinner time and maybe, long shot, be persuaded to run over to one of two equidistant schools and vote the Democratic slate. "There are way too many schools in Phoenix," Bill had said to me earlier. "Everywhere you look, here's a school, there's a school, all these charter schools. We just need one public school. Why do we need all these schools? It's taking money away." And I also recorded a great conversation with Bill, who's a native of Phoenix and who drove me around all day. Mostly, we saw children playing, clusters of black kids near one building, clusters of Latino kids around another. And we saw parents getting home, leading kids by the hand, black, Latino, and a smattering of whites, all working class. It was a textbook, low propensity voter site. There were some faintly promising conversations with Spanish-speaking moms and abuelas, brothers and dads about registered citizen family members who might make it home from work in time to vote. And there were two young men who gave me hope. Neither were registered. The first I found sitting in the dark, back of the building. He had a brother, Cesar, who was registered and whom he expected home momentarily. I asked him why he himself wasn't registered, and he said he didn't
know much about politics. I told him about Ruben Gallego, what a good representative he was, and how Adrian Fontes would protect their rights to vote and be counted. He didn't know that he could not vote online, but he was enthusiastic. I explained, okay, next time how he could register and how voting worked. Next time, I said, crossing the gravel towards the front of the buildings, yeah, I will, he said. Yeah, add your voice to the mix. No reason you shouldn't be a part of it. He agreed, laughing. The other young man came hopping out of the shadows, eyes a little too wide, and turned out to be a cable news addict, like myself. He, too, had not understood that he could not simply vote online. But boy, was he into politics.
Trump,
he said.
When are they going to indict that guy? Are they going to, huh? Just because he's a rich man, they will let him get away, and other people are poor and they get charged? So when are they going to charge him? Are they going to let him run for president again? Are they going to let him be president?
I agreed that the situation was outrageous and told him that someone who was as into the news as he was really should not skip another election.
Oh, I'm into the news, he said. I watch it all, Fox, CNN, MSNBC.
And then he mentioned a local affiliate and their report of a murder on Camelback Road.
They dismembered the body, he said, his eyes shining and widening. They found the decapitated head separate from the other parts. I told my mom, look, look.
I began to wonder if he'd been the culprit. But I dismissed this far-fetched notion and encouraged him, too, to add his vote and voice, his voice and vote next time. That's when I met Mom and Flip-Flops. It turned out that her standard, yeah, I'm registered, but I don't think I'll vote because I'm not into politics response, had to do with being conflicted. Her sister was big into politics, MAGA, Carrie Lake politics, and had given her a list of everything that she needed to go vote for. But she had not. The big meat was abortion. Her dad, too, said that abortion needed to be outlawed. Yeah, I know it's important. My sister keeps telling me politics is important. That's the only thing that your sister and I agree on, I told her. And I asked her, keeping my language vague within earshot of all the little kids, there was a snack truck there, so there's a lot of little kids swarming, what her feelings were about forcing raped children to give birth. And about doing zero about extreme weather, droughts, wildfires, the Colorado River drying up. More than one person in Phoenix told me they were very worried about running out of water for the whole city. As usual, I fingered my crucifix necklace, and I asked how a person of faith could balance the Pope's teachings about climate and poverty with his traditional Catholic view of abortion. She engaged me. She was not so sure she was for all of that outlawing. She'd not given it too much thought, but she took my point. Bill came and got me. The polls were closing in 10 minutes, and we'd been asked to go and check that the lines were honored up to the final minute. We said goodbye. Just think about it. Decide what you think. And then vote, I said. She nodded as the kids swarmed the snack buggy, taking turns to jump in the cab and sound the old-fashioned bulb horn. It was now officially nightfall. The full moon had risen. Bill would forego the big party in the hotel downtown and instead opt to drive me to a Denny's in North Phoenix, where I'd catch my Amtrak shuttle bus back to the Maricopa train station. He'd insist on buying me my cup of tea at Denny's because I'd come out and volunteered in his town, when friends and neighbors, in his opinion, had not done enough. We'd meet the high-cheekboned, thick-mustached James Dean, if he were 70, and Latino former truck driver Leo at the bus stop, dark bomber jacket, lean body, jeans and belts from Bakersfield, and his housewife grandmother companion returning from Flagstaff. They'd tell us of the reek of factory dairy farm and other toxins on the wind in Bakersfield, too, as well as in Maricopa. Bill would keep checking the news and showing us all the too-close-to-call reports. He'd wait with us for the shuttle, even though it came 40 minutes late. And then, with a hug and a hope we'll celebrate soon, Election Day, Phoenix is over. I'm on a shuttle driven by an immigrant Latina woman,
and my fellow passengers are a young black woman from my hometown of Oakland, a Somali guy from mom's town of Minneapolis, and the two Bakersfielders, represented shittily by Kevin McCarthy. In an hour, I'll board another Sunset Limited and complete my 3-week journey in Los Angeles. Last swing, last whistle, no more stops. I'm going to miss it, this beautiful country and all of its places and peoples. Summer. So Summer, I did another travelogue that I put on Facebook initially, and now it's migrated over to Substack. And it was a sort of more poetic and personal. It was a correspondence with my 17-year-old self is what it evolved into. I called it a time travelogue. I moved to New York for the second time this summer after moving in the summer of 1981 when I was 17. So 41 years later, or however damn many years later, I started posting diary entries 2 days after I turned 17 years old. I arrived in New York, so I started posting diary entries all summer long, and then I would write a response entry, sort of what I was doing that day, or sometimes a response to my 17-year-old self. All right, so just one little closer, a little taste of that. Sunday, July 12th, 1981. Lying on the roof amidst the rooftops with Jenny, my fingers smell of cigarettes and salt water. It's nice out here on the roof. We've laid out a mattress and we're gonna sleep here tonight. The moon swings serenely through the rusty powder clouds in and out of vision. It gleams like a pearl button from frayed folds of felt. A phone is ringing somewhere. Incomprehensible human cries drift from the neighbor's windows. My line of vision affords only a squat Brooklyn skyline, two-story flats dwarfed by Manhattan skyscrapers, which tower unseen nearby, somewhere in the obscure north. The telephone wires and clotheslines crisscross through the still and tepid air. Above all this are thin metal flags of television antennas alongside old brick chimneys. Blocking this is a tree, which is higher than the rest of it, except for the moon and the sky. A tree grows in Brooklyn. The summer moon, coarse voices, squares of yellow light, sheets and towels hung out to dry. Everyone is sure it will not rain. Jenny is asleep. I am alone, worried, dejected, and wistful. Mostly I'm just apathetic, in a gray limbo that knows no fear, only worries, and no pain, only loneliness. This night, on Tuesday, July 12th, 2022, I'm still processing today's mesmerizing day 7, January 6th hearing, composed with excoriating compassion by the poet, politician, patriot, hero, Representative Jamie Raskin. I'm reeling from the sheer, unadulterated heartbreak of witnessing those whom the monster duped, in tandem with the full-blown Grand Guignol comedy of his co-conspirators. I also today walked in a hot wind at high tide. Waves hurriedly scupping New York Harbor, almost covering the rocks. And after the sun dipped behind Staten Island, we, up on the overpass, heard a young Vietnamese man shout and saw him pull on his fishing line, and other fishing men, Latino and Asian, ran to his side to see and to offer help. He had to walk a long ways, passing the pole over other men's poles and letting the fish swim itself out. I saw a flash of silver strapping big fish as he at last pulled it out of the water. He climbed over the rail down to the rocks and let the fish go, I think. He held up hands 2 feet apart to indicate how big the fish was. Good, I thought. Who's going to eat this fish? There's a waste treatment facility on the other side of 69th Street Pier. I mean, come on. The sky was shockingly striated and cream puff clouded and spired and washed and melted and shot through and dark slabbed with an orgasmic riot of shifting pinks, corals, crimsons, tiepolo blues, chromes, silver grays, cream blues. And this same over-the-top sky had Manhattan and the Statue of Liberty and a really gargantuan chock full of containers cargo ship called Yang Ming to frame it. So the sky was just ridiculously beautiful and stupid to try to photograph or describe unless you're possessed by divine inspiration. But of course, here I am trying to describe it just as I tried to describe my cousin Jenny's rooftop that July night in 1981. Things the same. Clouds are still impossible for me to describe, but I try. Trees grow in Brooklyn. People still watch television. Salt water and cigarettes. Things changed. The Brooklyn skyline. Not as many clotheslines out, few antennas, but more little American flags. Phones still ring, but everywhere, not somewhere, in chosen and branded tones. I am alone this night, but not lonely. I'm not apathetic, and I do fear. And more things the same, I am ever wistful. We are all in a gray limbo. The moon is a pearl button.